I will meditate therein both day and night, on a chapter in the morning and a chapter in the evening. And because I do, my life is blessed. It's no more a mess. Now everything I touch, now turns to success. Amen, amen. We'll put your hands together and let's welcome everybody. So let's go ahead and pray. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this another opportunity to meditate your word. Your word indeed is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We ask you to shine the light of your word to us today. In the name of Jesus, give us ears that hear and a heart that's open and receptive to your word. We give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless you. You may be seated. Just before we get into the message for today, I want to just encourage you. I talked about water baptism just a bit last week. If you are born again and you've never been baptized in water since you've been saved, sometimes our parents had us baptized as kids, but we didn't come to know the Lord until we were adults. I was baptized as a child, but I believe in my heart that I really knew the Lord as a child. And I grew up knowing the Lord, and I wanted to be baptized, and I was baptized. So since then, I haven't been baptized again. That doesn't mean I've lived a perfect life as a Christian. That doesn't mean that after my baptism that I've never sinned or done things that I would, that I could be ashamed of. But what it does mean is that when I gave my life to Christ, I also was water baptized. If you've not yet been water baptized, whether you're here in the church or watching us online, let me encourage you to do so. We've got water baptism coming up on June the 30th. There's a class that we would like for you to take on June 23rd after the 10:30 service. And if you use this baptism card in your offering envelope, that'll allow you to sign up. And there's a place where you can choose a t-shirt. We've got a brand new t-shirt that, thank you. We've got a brand new t-shirt that we've designed just as a memorabilia for you, that if you are baptized in water, something that you can remember that by. And so fill out that card for you, yourself or your child, and amen. We can fulfill the commandment of Christ to believe and be baptized. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Well, we're getting ready to go into the Word of God again today. We've already prayed. And so open with me in your Bible to the book of Jonah. And we're going to start this time in chapter 2. We're continuing a series that I started last week in Jonah. And we'll start in verse number 7. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy, but I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. Amen. Well, if you've ever read the story of Jonah, you know that God came to him and told him, I want you to go do something, gave him a task. Along with that came some responsibility to carry out the command of God. Well, Jonah decided to run in the opposite direction. And so last week we started a brand new series called Like Jonah. And the quest in this particular series is for you and I to look in our lives to see if there are any areas in our lives where we are like Jonah. There's four parts to this particular series. One of them is, and which we've already covered, is running from God. Are you like Jonah in your life running from God. And we've covered that. Today we're going to look at running from responsibilities. And then we're also going to look at running from the call of God that's on your life. And then lastly, running from commitment. And so I don't want you just to immediately dismiss and figure, no, I'm not like Jonah. I literally want you to look for areas in your life where God said one thing and then you went in a different direction. Amen? Amen. So as I was meditating, I actually got really excited after I left church last Sunday because I didn't know if I was going to preach a traditional Father's Day message today and then pick up the story of like Jonah on the next week. And of course, today our theme is a good father. But sometimes fathers can be like Jonah and run from responsibility. Amen. And I want you to find yourself. Is this you? I know this is Usain Bolt. Running from, as this meme says, running from my responsibilities, like in this case, you know, he's trying to get away. And in this message, I want to highlight, just like there's three guys that are lagging behind or look like they're trying to chase after this world-class athlete, this champion. There's three responsibilities. In your life, you have spiritual responsibilities. You have family responsibilities. And you have financial responsibilities. I'm sure there's many other things. There's personal responsibilities. And we can just go down the list. But I'm led of the Lord to ask you to examine in your life if you are any way like Jonah running from responsibility. When you talk about the responsibility of a man, one of the things that I learned early on is that what makes a man is not his genitalia. Just because you have the genetic makeup of a man doesn't make you a man. It makes you a male. But when you ask the question, what makes a man, it truly is the acceptance of responsibility. How many of you have come to learn that over time? And that's truly when we become an adult and a man or a woman, is when we accept the responsibility that God has. And so I'm just going to take some time to show you from the Word of God these various kinds of responsibilities and how each of us may in our lives in one way or another be running from areas of responsibility. Some people, you know, I don't want that responsibility. No, thank you. I don't want that. Have you ever seen that or been there where people in their lives, you know, I just rather not get involved in that because I don't want to carry that responsibility. Well, if that thing is something that God is presenting you and giving you, you can't reject it or you shouldn't run from it. You should look to fulfill your responsibilities. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse number 9, this is the story where God created Adam and his wife, put them in the garden, told them to dress it and keep it, gave them work, gave them the assignment, and he would visit and fellowship with them every day. He gave them one command to not eat of the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What an apple tree. Amen. But he told them not to eat of that fruit, but they still had to work for it. Some people have likened tithing to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the garden. It's something that you have to work for, but you don't get to partake of. I got one amen. That's good enough. I'll move on. Amen. But in any case, they would have to dress this tree. They would have to be around this tree. They would have to keep it. They would have to attend to it. You know, I can imagine maybe they'd have to prune it. And so one day, the wife was standing by this tree, and the serpent was there and beguiled her, tricked her. She partook of it, did what God told her not to do. And her husband, knowingly, he was wasn't beguiled. He made a conscious decision to go against what God has said, to go in an opposite direction from the Lord. And sure enough, the moment that they did it, unrighteousness showed up. The feeling of shame and inferiority and fear and condemnation and guilt. They met fig leaves and covered themselves. And when they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the cool of the day, like he had always done, they ran and they hid themselves. I want you to watch this. In verse number 9, the Bible says, "Then the Lord God called to Adam and said, 'Where are you?'" Notice that he didn't call to Adam and his wife. In a moment, he's going to talk to her. But he came to the head of that household first. And if you're here today and you're male, and then I'm talking to you. If you're here today and you're female and you're a head of household, then I'm talking to you in this moment. Why? Because you have a spiritual responsibility regarding your family, regarding your life. He came to the head of that house to find out what's going on. And please understand this, God never asks a question for his benefits. Man, that's good. When you understand that, it'll help you when you read the Word of God. Just the other Sunday, we were looking at the story where Jesus turned the loaves and the fish and multiplied them and fed the 5,000. You all remember that? He asked one of them a question. He says, "Where can we buy food so that these can eat?" He already knew in himself what he was going to do. Anytime the Lord asks a question, it's not for his benefit. God is all-knowing.
Right.
He knew exactly where Adam was. Matter of fact, if you were to go to the next verse, it says that, he says, "Have you eaten of the tree that I told you not to eat of?" Do you think that God is really asking him for his benefit? No. Anytime God asks you a question, it is for your benefit. What's going on? He's giving him an opportunity to take responsibility for his action. And Adam didn't. He didn't take his responsibility. He blamed his wife. The woman you gave him. When he realized that Adam's not going to handle this properly, he asked the wife a question, giving her, not for his benefit, but for hers, giving her the opportunity. My question to you today is not, "Adam, where are you?" It's, "Where are you? Where are you right now? Are you like Adam, running from responsibilities in your life and in your relationship with God?" Let's cover this first point. One of those guys that's running after is spiritual responsibilities. Successful Christians, these things are, if you're going to be successful in your Christian life, then these are going to be characteristic in your life. Number one, successful Christians meditate the Word of God daily. Are you running from that responsibility? God said, not Pastor Stan. "Yeah, I had you lift up your Bible and make a confession, but it's only a confession of what God said in Joshua chapter 1. He said, not me, "This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein both day and night, that you may observe to do everything that's in it. Then you'll have good success." Maybe you are like Jonah, where you are going through some really tough times in your life. And Jonah, when he went in an opposite direction, other than the way, he ran into some really, really tough times. And sometimes, not every time, but sometimes when you're going through tough times in your life, it's an indication that you're going in a wrong direction. Matter of fact, the Bible says that the Lord blew a strong wind against the ship that was resist the proud. But he gives grace to the humble. Are the tough times in your life not tragedy and calamity? But the difficulties that you're experiencing, is it God resisting you? Yeah, you may feel like it's your boss and she's this or he is that and I can't stand this and it's just a constant grind. And you wonder why you're dealing with that. Is it that you are not handling your responsibility, that you haven't accepted properly your responsibility? Another thing that successful Christians do is they pray every day. Another thing that successful Christians do is they attend church weekly. And a fourth thing that successful Christians do is they serve on a dream team.
Amen.
And, you know, I know some people have passions beyond the local church, and they involve serving the community and serving and with different organizations and different projects. If you live your life only for yourself and you don't volunteer to help others and to do good, then you're missing responsibilities that God has given you through his word. Amen? Amen. So you and I, we have spiritual responsibilities. Where are you? Are you running from yours? In 1 Kings chapter 19, this is a man of God, Elijah, who was running, ran into a really tough time. He's going through. He got to the point where he hated his life. He wanted to die. But the Spirit of God, an angel came and ministered to him, gave him some food and some strength, and he was able to go into that strength because he needed to get in a place where he could hear from God. And God came to him in that place because he's running from responsibility, running essentially from where he's supposed to be. God came to him in 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse 9. And there he went into a cave and he spent the night in that place. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Again, always remember, anytime God asks a question, it's not for his benefit, it's for our benefit. What is he trying to? He's trying to get us to take or accept responsibility. My question is to you, not is what is Elijah doing here, is what are you doing? In your personal life, what are you doing? I woke up, this clearly claimed to me, I don't know who it's for, but one of the biggest lies that the enemy, my brother's here, so I always mess up big words, so propagate, can you propagate a lie? It's kind of a word. How about perpetrate? Propagate. One of the biggest lies that the enemy tries to get people to believe is that you shouldn't go to church because of how you're living. You're running from these simple spiritual responsibilities because of stuff you're doing in your life. And we dealt very clearly that sin in your life is not the big deal. What is the big deal in your life is the unrighteousness that comes as a result of the sin. You may be watching this and you may be in a situation where you're living with someone of the opposite sex, or in this day and age, maybe someone of the same sex. And the guilt, the condemnation, and the shame is what keeps you from being where you're supposed to be. You've been running from your spiritual responsibilities. There was a woman just like that, living in a place where she wasn't married to the God, and Jesus loved her. Spent time intentionally to get her into the place where she was supposed to be. My question to you is, what are you doing that's keeping you from accepting responsibility? What's going on in your life that causes you to say, "Well, no, I can't serve because I got this going on. I still drink, I still smoke, I still do this, I still watch that, and you know, so I'm just going to be on the outskirts of God or of the things of God. I'm not going to heavily involve myself because I'm not worthy. And so I'm not going to take responsibilities that put me in relationship with God in a way that I don't feel that I'm worthy. God's asking you, what in your life are you doing that's causing you to run from responsibility? And remember, he's asking for your benefit. That woman that I referred to is in John chapter 4 and verse 16. Jesus said to her, right in the middle of a conversation, he said, go call your husband and come here. Well, he already knew that the guy that she was calling her husband, that wasn't her husband, that she was lying about, yeah, well, go call your husband. Come here. The second note that I want to make is that you have family responsibilities.
Amen.
Don't run from your family responsibilities. We're here on Father's Day, and it's a celebration in proper order. The Bible says to honor your father and your mother. You have one of the greatest things my dad ever taught me, and I believe it would at least be echoed within the top five of the great things for my siblings, is that he taught us something that his father taught him. He taught us, he said, take care of your family. My grandfather told that to my dad. My dad told that to all of us, and he tells us all, take care of your family. We have, all of us, family responsibilities. Notice Jesus told this woman, go call your husband. There's responsibility here. Of course, she went and got him, and all the men in her city ended up being, she was being used of God. There's a command here in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 23. It says, the husband is the head of the wife. I want to talk about heads of households for a moment, and particularly the men that are in here in the church and those that are watching. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also the Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Now, I guess this scripture almost today might be politically incorrect because, you know, in this day of equality, you know, it's the husband and the wife, and they are the head of the family. No. You can think that if you want. But in the mind of God, amen, the husband is. I got one amen. Amen. The husband is the head of the wife. What that means, husband, is that you have spiritual responsibility for your family. Their condition, their accountability, their outcome. And you cannot run from that responsibility. In the same way, you have a responsibility as it relates to your family. One of the grievous things in the earth today is fatherless homes. 40% of every child born in America, this is from the census.gov, the Bureau of Vital Statistics. This is you can Google it. I'm big time, y'all. There's in records, every baby born on record in a hospital in the United States is recorded. 40% are born to a woman who's not married. Well, that's not automatic that father won't be a part of that child's life, but I can tell you this. In many of those occasions, things don't work out between that man and woman because there's nothing tying them together. They can leave if they want to leave. Hey, I'm about tired of that. I'm out of here, right? You know, you're not gonna keep talking, doing what I'm doing. And if you knew that, then that's just how I am. You knew that when you met me. And so that doesn't work out, and now he's gone over here and got a child over there, and then she's now, you know, connected with somebody else, and that's not that child's biological father, and now we've got blended families, and things are not. Listen, it's so important, whether you're married or not, if you have children, take care of your family. Shouldn't have to be chasing you down for child support. That's for everybody on the internet. And it goes for both heads of households. So, single mom, you know, single woman, or if you're a head of household, you have responsibility where your family is concerned. Ephesians chapter 6, this is for fathers. He says in verse 4, fathers, do not provoke your children in wrath. Fathers, bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. You know, so often we get in the mind that the wife is supposed to raise the kids. And I ever have to watch that because we're entering now into parenthood. This first-time parents and you know, got a 2.5-year-old and 11-month-old. Hey, he took a couple steps today for Father's Day. What is it good for? Just 2 steps, though, and then he was holding on, okay? But we're walking into that where now, you know, I get up and I'm gone and I'm gone. And then when I get back, I might get involved and change a diaper or two, right? You know, maybe wipe off the mouth a little bit. But, you know, then, you know, we play games and so forth. My wife went out of town to visit family for a week and left both boys with me. I have so much respect for women and moms. Like, God bless you. Happy Mother's Day. Because parenting kids is no joke, am I right? Huge responsibility. Amen. And that's of the Lord. But fathers are the ones. We shouldn't go with that the mothers bring up the kids, but the fathers should bring them up in the nurturing aspect. That's family responsibility. Now, I just want to give you this because I taught this a while ago on a message about sons and daughters. And, you know, if you don't have it, try to go on the internet and get it. But successful parents do these 3 things or should know these 3 things. Number one, successful parents train 0 to 12-year-old children. They teach 12 to 19-year-old children. But biblically, at the age of 20, something happens. And the parenting of an adult son or daughter is now different. You advise 20 and over sons and daughters. I believe we've absolutely got this backwards. In the world today, I believe I see parents with grown sons and daughters that are trying to train them. Parents with 12 to 19-year-olds that are trying to advise them. Parents of 0 to 12-year-olds that are trying to teach them. He can't even talk good. Amen. It's so important. And the big thing that we should be doing with our children and our family responsibility is we should be training, teaching, and advising them in the acceptance of responsibility. 0 on up. My advice to the 20-year-old adult son or daughter is, you know, you should take responsibility for your actions. Right. I don't talk to them. I only have the 2 kids, but I wouldn't talk to a 20-year-old son or daughter as if they were a child. Right. Trying to teach them a lesson. Hey, all that time is past. Right. They just need your godly advice and the acceptance of responsibility. Let's keep going. In the book of Proverbs, this blessed me, right? So we read in our chapters, as everybody at Faith Family Church reads their Bible every day, Monday through Friday, and Proverbs chapter 3 was one of our chapters. And in Proverbs chapter 3, I noticed that he said, my son, do this, do this. My son, hear the instruction of your father. And it blessed me because it put me in the mind that the entire book of Proverbs is a father taking responsibility for his son, training them, teaching them, instructing them, giving them words of advice. Amen. I then went back and I had to pull it out for today because this is family responsibility. In Proverbs chapter 1, he says, my son, hear the instruction of your father and do not forsake the law of your mother. Now, I didn't have time, But 22 different times in the entire book of Proverbs, he says, my son, my son. And listen, when the guy wrote Proverbs, he wasn't writing Proverbs. He was just writing a letter to his son about living life. I've talked to you about it in the flesh, but I want you to have this. I'm writing this down. And God used Solomon to pen words as his own words, as God's own words, for our benefit. How many of y'all see a father taking responsibility where his family is concerned? Amen?
Amen.
Matter of fact, David taught Solomon. And then Solomon taught David. Taught his son. Amen.
Amen.
And so it is important for you and I in our lives to take family responsibility. In that same chapter, in that same passage of scripture, in Proverbs 13, verse 22, it says this. A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, but the wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous. The word man here is in italics. What that means is the translators added it for clarity, you know, to make a complete sentence. I'd like to substitute for man here father or even head of household. Because a good father, what makes a good father is that he takes family responsibility. And one of the kinds of responsibilities that we have, all of us, is financial responsibility. As I look at this third part, that third person that could be running. You have financial responsibility. A good father makes sure that if he were to pass, something's left, not just for the kids, but for the kids' kids. It's getting quiet. I don't know, in the day and age that we live, it just almost seems unreasonable for you to not have life insurance. And I'm not just talking to the men or the fathers, I'm talking to everybody. For a person that's like 35 and under, in basic good health, for about $15 a month, you can get a 10-year term life insurance policy for just $15 a month. That if something happened between now and 10 years, that your family would be left with something. Now, there's other policies that are much more expensive than that, you know, that the span of time is different. What's my point? It's irresponsible.
Right.
Am I preaching good?
Amen.
And one of the things that the Bible teaches us is to take financial responsibility. Look at this. Listen how strong this is. In 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse number 8, can you put it up for me? He says, but if anyone, notice it didn't just point to the fathers and men, but he says, if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially those of his own household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. So how many of y'all see here that one of the major responsibilities in life is that we have financial responsibility? And I'm not just talking about life insurance. I'm just talking about in general where our children are concerned. Remember, adult sons and daughters are not children. I got one. They on their own. Dave Ramsey says, you don't set aside for their college until after you've provided for your retirement. If your retirement is not set, then no college.
Wow.
Now, he's just a multimillionaire that's ministered to millions of people. It's just a point of advice. Amen. But the point is, where your children are concerned, make sure that they're taken care of your family.
Amen.
Amen. In Matthew chapter 12, also remember this, you have family responsibilities. So we dealt with spiritual responsibility, we dealt with financial, we dealt with family responsibility. But also remember We dealt with family responsibility. Remember that believers are also your family. Jesus said, Jesus was in a certain place and they came to him and said, your mom and your brothers are outside. They want to talk to you. Jesus stretched his hands out. He says, who is my mother and my father? Or who is my mother and my brothers? These are my mother and my brothers. He stretched his hands out to his disciples. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother, my sister, and mother. Amen. Notice he didn't put my father. That's a very unique thing because several times in the scripture, you only get one father. Mothers could be at, you know, somebody can love you like a mom would love you because that's an amazing kind of love in and of itself. Amen. But several times he didn't include him in a list of fathers. But my point is this. Where your church family is concerned, is there sometimes that your church family is more your family than your natural family? And if you haven't developed a strong, good relationship with your church family, what are you waiting on? We want to be your faith family, not your fake family.
Amen.
We want to be there with you in times of crisis. We want to celebrate the victories that you have in life. We want to stand by you. We declare that we become family for life.
Amen.
There's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. You can have a non-blood relative that will stand by you and be by your side and be with you to the end. Amen? In the book of Galatians, chapter 6 and verse 10, the Bible says that therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. The reason why I pointed out that your church family is a part of your family is because you have a financial responsibility where your family is concerned. I want to talk for a moment about tithes and offerings. Now, you all know, we preach here that you don't gotta tithe, you get to tithe.
Amen.
There's no commandment in the New Testament that commands you, like they were in the Old Testament, to give 10% of your income to the Lord. You get to do it just like Abraham got to do it. He decided in his heart. First time tithing was ever mentioned was by a man who just made a personal heart decision, I'm going to give God a tenth of my income. Everything that comes in, I'm going to give him 10%. Moses, after that, came and gave a law and told the children of Israel, 10% of everything you have is mine. That's what God said. But that was done away with the law. And now it's restored back to you, giving freely from your heart. But let me tell you this. Are you running from your responsibility, financial responsibility, where your church home is concerned? No, it's very quiet. Is your church taken care of? There's responsibility here. I recently celebrated a huge victory. Last year on June the 10th, it was a Sunday, on Monday, I was driving and I was thinking about finances, and as a church, we had been in a place where it's just, we're living from week to week, just like most people in America live from check to check. And I heard the Spirit of God on the inside of my heart challenge me something. In other words, he said to me that if I would be careful to tithe, not assume that I'm a tither, because we give, but to be very attentive, and that for everything that comes in, to specifically make sure that we give a tenth, that we would see things change in our future. And from that day to this, I've been on a mission to make sure that 100% of the 10% that comes in, of all that comes into Faith Family, we give to other churches and ministries.
Amen.
Amen? Amen. And on this week, we wrote out our tithe checks, and glory to God, from June 10th, 2018 to June 12th or 13th of 2019, we have given 10% of every single thing that's coming.
Amen.
Amen. That's worth celebrating, y'all. You know why? The days will come where we're not living from paycheck to paycheck. It marvels me. The attendance has been down because of graduations and vacations and different things, but the offerings have not dropped at all. And we don't even pass the collection plate.
Come on.
We got a box in the foyer that you can drop in your offering if you choose to give. But most of us are giving through the internet and through technology. My challenge to you today is from the Lord. Are you taking spiritual responsibility for yourself? Are you taking family responsibility for your family? And are you taking financial responsibility in your life? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You know, in a family, you can stand up on your feet. In a family, everybody has a job. You have family responsibilities. Serving on a dream team is not a joke. It's important. Because if you're not doing your part, then that means somebody else has to do it as well as theirs. I challenge you, don't run from godly responsibility. Amen?
Amen.